everyone. Welcome back to my channel. I'm going to eat my breakfast slash lunch while I talk to you guys. And while we review this video on Jubilee about abortion, you guys have requested for a while for me to talk about abortion, especially after the Texas bill went through. And you guys know that I have sort of a nuanced perspective of abortion, and I am open to criticism. If you guys want, you know, leave those in the comment sections down below. But let's go ahead and watch Jubilee react to Is Abortion Murder Middle Ground?
Nobody likes abortions.
I don't think anyone likes it. I think they use it, and they might use it incorrectly from my perspective, but I don't think anyone likes an abortion. Like, they're not like jumping for joy for it.
I think it is a very physically taxing process to go through, and I don't think anyone would want to intentionally have an abortion. I think those who get an abortion, most of the time, it's because they need to.
It's a harmful narrative on both sides of the conversation to say that, you know, women celebrate abortion. I think it creates a prejudice around women who do get abortions. And I don't think that it's good to kind of minimize the decision of abortion from either side, from either perspective.
I think if you asked me this question maybe several years ago, I would have said nobody likes abortion. But I think in today's climate, it is much more celebrated. As a pro-life person, I've had people tell me that they will dedicate their next abortion to me. Instead of helping women, they will have an abortion.
I've heard very similar responses to you. Things like, I'll donate to Planned Parenthood in your name. And there's other pages like Shout Your Abortion that openly celebrates abortion rights.
Okay, wait, whoa, whoa, whoa. So that the conservative religious, non-religious slash pro-life side might say, oh, this is like harmful. And it is. It's insulting to their belief systems. And I think the people who donate in the name of Planned Parenthood and the name of those people are also just like petty, passionate people that feel like they're being attacked. These are two bubbles, two solutions and two bubbles. That girl before, you know, looked a little, you know, she had some nuance energy, right? But I think in general, you can obviously tell like these are two conversations being had. There has to be a winner or a loser. Let's see if someone says something a little bit more layered.
Yeah, I celebrate abortion, and I think that campaigns like Shout Your Abortion aren't about like getting in your face, but women who choose to have abortions suffer a lot of stigma and trauma from people who stand outside clinics and have grotesque images and literally, you know, damning your soul.
So I just want to say this really fast. When she said like, oh, they'll have grotesque imagery, what she means is they'll have like aborted fetuses slash babies, depending on how you face this reality of ending a human life in progress. But I've been there. I've been on the pro-life marches. I've been to Washington. I've done those marches with the pro-life movement. And it feels really empowering when you're there. You really feel like you're doing something for women. You hear from women who have had abortions and regret it. So you feel really needed. And then on top of that, you know what I mean? These images are just reality. The reality is that like when you terminate a human life in progress, it comes out like a whole jumbled jambalaya meal. Like it's just like a blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? It is what it is. And sometimes it's just clear what you can see. And sometimes it's clear you can't see. But either which way, we can all agree that abortion in the least is a termination of a human life in progress. And then we can debate what does a human life in progress look like and what does that mean? And then we can have a conversation maybe around that and then even deeper. The point of bringing up this woman is because pro-lifers will use her own language against her. She says they're grotesque images. So then you agree having an abortion is grotesque. Do you get what I'm saying?
Medical procedure and resource is something that I do celebrate. It's a human right. And I love abortion.
I love abortion. No judgment, girl. You're in a bubble. But you can see this as two language, right? We love abortion for a lot of things, but all of them are rooted in a desire to fulfill a need. And mostly the need of the person carrying the child, right? So again, when we're having these conversations to make statements like, I love abortion, is so weird to me. That's like saying, I love the death penalty. It's like, okay, I guess. Like, I guess it's helpful and I guess it's helped some people, but it's also fucked over a lot of people, bro. And in a lot of situations, those women don't even want to get abortions, but they feel like they have to because of their circumstances. Maybe if we had better health care, women wouldn't be getting abortions. Maybe if conservatives wanted to help women, you know, not abort their babies, maybe they would make it less hard to have a baby. Without insurance, it could be up to $50,000 in a U.S. hospital. With a doula, it's about $8,000 in cash. Do you know what I'm saying? Or we can just like do it ourselves, I guess, in our living rooms, which, you know, my grandmas and grandmas and grandmas did that for generations, so... You know.
My name is Rocky. I use she, her pronouns. I'm from Austin, Texas, and I am very pro-abortion. I think that legislation like SB 8 opens the door and the path towards handing over our bodily autonomy to the state.
One, your identity is so easily accessible to others that you say it in a sentence like a billboard, which is fine, no judgment, girl, but I know there's more to you than that. Two, I think it's really interesting that she's talking about bodily autonomy, because you guys know that's my argument for being pro-choice, is that I might think it's terminating a human life in progress, i.e. a baby in progress, but for me, you know, bodily autonomy has to trump that, just like bodily autonomy trumps everything, including vaccination mandates.
I don't understand how anyone can justify using their personal beliefs to take away the rights of others.
Yeah, me neither, girl. Me neither.
My name's Abby. I'm from Orlando, Florida, and I'm an abolitionist of human abortion. We have to ask the question of what makes humans valuable. So because my worldview as a Christian gives me a foundation for human worth, and because I believe scientifically fetuses are human beings from the moment of conception, I am against abortion.
Right away, she's telling you who she is, just like the other woman. She's using an identifier of a group to make sure people know who she is. She shortcuts her identities to even quicker than the woman before her. She literally says, I'm a Christian, which for you and me and the listener is supposed to know what that means, right? Maybe anti-LGBT, they worship Jesus or the person known as Jesus. They're pro-life, so on and so forth, right? Like she's giving us a word to allow us to know what to categorize her as. Which is why generalizations do have a place within society, obviously. I think it's really cool that both of these people, so far we've seen very strong personalities, very passionate, both not understanding the other because they both live in bubbles. But see, they don't see that. They see their bubble as the ultimate objective reality. But if you need your identifiers to allow people to know what you're about to say next, and I can almost predict it by those identifiers, we should have conversations about whether or not we're having authentic, real thoughts or whether we're just piggybacking completely off everybody else, not even the shoulders of giants, but like everyone around us. Are we people pleasing to the point of not having an opinion of our own because we're too afraid to face what that means? We have to face our own ideologies to really have a conversation that doesn't involve, you know, this black and white premise. But anyways,
biological fathers should have an equal say in abortions.
Both parents have to agree.
I agree. I have talked to lots of women who've had abortions, and I've talked to lots of men who are hurting. They're completely heartbroken. They would have raised the baby. They wanted to raise the baby. They begged for the life of the baby. And they obviously created the baby together, but only one of them gets to decide if their child gets to live or die.
You left us, man. I want to know why.
There's a struggle.
Yeah. I'm mad conflicted about this. Because I strongly feel like a man should not have control over what a woman does with her body. I more so have an issue with when a man doesn't actually want that baby. She wants it and then expects this man to like be the ultimate provider and child care and all this extra stuff, right? But in the case of if the man wanted it, the baby, and the woman didn't want it, he has no say-so. I think that's a fucked up dynamic. So that's why I was going back and forth.
Ooh, that's a fucked up dynamic. I think that summarizes most of our social interactions. A lot of us have fucked up dynamics and we're not honest about it.
Well, you should have stayed then. It sounds like you're for men having more rights.
I just can't force a woman to be like, no, you have to do this, because I think it's fucked up. It's her body.
But it's also a child's life in there. It's not just her body, it's a child's life.
And it's also your son or daughter.
My name is Asher, currently reside in Las Vegas, and I'm for pro-abortion. I used to be against abortion until an unwanted pregnancy happened to me. If you know for a fact that you're not even gonna be the best parent for that child, or you can't provide for that child, or maybe you're just fearful and don't wanna pop a child out of you, or just whatever reason that you have, I feel like you shouldn't have to go through with that. You still have that choice over your life, your body.
I like him. He's fun. Asher's fun. Asher's in the middle of really contemplating that. You see how he brought that balance, that he spoke loudly and clearly about why he's in conflict with abortion. And at the same time, I think he's probably going to go down a deeper path of like really contemplating it. In contrast, you could see as he was switching sides, people were getting like disappointed or more excited. Like people were reacting. Even if it's subtle, like people were reacting. And they wanted him on their side. Like, that definitely was the energy I was getting. And so you could see him in conflict, but he's asking himself real questions.
I have had an abortion.
A few months ago, I found out that I was pregnant. When I imagined myself finding out I was pregnant for the first time, I wanted it to be celebrated. And in that moment, I felt such severe anxiety. And I felt, and having that, I felt like the entire time I was just in a lot of emotional pain, grieving. I was debating about myself, about what, how I would be looked at or how I would view myself after getting the procedure done.
I ain't gonna lie, I'm nervous. So I'm be real careful with my words. Clearly, as a man, I can't have an abortion. But my girlfriend, we've had two abortions. She didn't really want to have a baby. I didn't really want to have a baby. And I know for me, I don't want to be that seen as that deadbeat father person, but I knew I wasn't really trying to sacrifice my own dreams or what I was trying to accomplish to be a dad at that point.
All right, so these last two people, I think, are the most authentic of the group. You can tell by their demeanor, the way they think about things, the way they state their opinions. You can see there's even conflict within their body language. So they're not just coming with a lot of pride, like, I'm pro-abortion, I love it. I'm pro-life, I love it. They're going, yeah, I did a thing that was human and hard, and it impacted me. And at the same time, I know it was the right answer. Like, you can see they're impacted in how they're talking about it, but you can also see they're authentic.
When I found out I was pregnant, the person that I was with at the time, they were like, I will support you in every way, but I will not be able to be there for you if you decide to keep it. And that definitely influenced my choice. It was one of the hardest decisions I've ever had to make. I like to think I'm a pretty generous, like, loving person, and the names that I've been called for even getting one, I've gotten evil, psychotic, demented.
My name is Christine. I'm from Denver, and I am on the anti-abortion side. So when I was 20 years old, I was a college student, and I found myself in an unplanned pregnancy, and I was pressured to abort very heavily, not only by my child's father, but by those around me. And I heard my son's heartbeat, and there was no debate. It was a life. His life was not mine to take. This is part of why I am very pro-life, because I know many women are pressured to abort when they don't want to.
So this is a great example of two really authentic stories that both contradict the other only in action and result, but not really in feeling. Both of these women felt like they had to make a choice. Both of them made it sound like they did it alone, because the pro-life woman even said her own boyfriend was telling her to abort, right? There was pressure around her, so both of them had to be alone in this. Both of them ultimately had to make the decision, and both don't regret their decision. We are all experiencing life in similar ways. It just looks different because it's the opposite. I see these two women, and I don't really see big differences between the two, except the really shallow and obvious ones.
Your story is absolutely powerful, and your story as well. I think something we probably all can agree on is abortion usually is a symptom of a bigger problem, whether it's finances, whether it's stability of housing, whether it's relationship issues. My perspective is that we address those issues instead of ending the life of a child.
I disagree. I don't think that abortion is a symptom. People should be able to access abortion when, how, wherever.
I think the biggest thing is that there are birth control methods out there, and abortion should not be a birth control method.
I thank you for everyone sharing their stories so far. I didn't step forward. I haven't had an abortion myself, but I am a survivor of rape. I was on birth control at the time, and I still made the decision with my medical team that birth control is not 100% effective, and I wanted access to emergency contraceptive to take on top of that. And had that pregnancy or any of those methods failed, I would have chosen to have an abortion, and I'm very grateful that I had access to those resources, and I'm so mindful that there's so many women who don't.
Well, I think it gets down to the heart of the issue here. You know, what is the unborn? Which scientifically the embryo is from conception, a living whole organism with distinct DNA. As a Christian, I come from a worldview that says that every human being has dignity and worth.
Not to disrespect any religion in general, but in my eyes, that's just pushing a belief onto someone rather than actually stating a real concrete fact.
So is she stating that the fetus being a baby is not scientific, or is a belief, or is she saying that the religion itself is the belief? Because this is the conundrum with, like, these bubbles. See how these bubbles interact and they overlap? And I wanted to give them a chance to kind of speak for a second. You know how I tell you some people talk in billboard speak? This man did. You know, every life is sacred. I would have celebrated life. Like, these are things I've heard from other people when they speak with billboard speak. They'll be like, trans women are women. And it's like, okay, I don't know why you had to make it so weird. But, like, they're looking for a fight. And it's like we create these positive or negative like sentence structures and socialization cues that I think confuse people. All right. So taking into consideration that all these people are coming from different bubbles and different experiences, I do think it's fair that all of them are right. That for some people, like the pro-choice lady, abortion isn't just a reaction to environment. Maybe I have everything. Maybe I'm a multimillionaire. Maybe I could be a mom. Maybe a lot of things. I should still have bodily autonomy and be allowed to do what I need to do, right? Now, I do agree that as a healthy society, as people become more healthy, I would argue abortions will go down naturally because people won't be, no offense, having sex with people that are bad. Or, you know, to the extent in which we are, because let's be real, generational, like, healing happens. I know more than my mother. I avoided a lot of her mistakes and made a few of my own. And next generation hopefully will be better. So my daughter, instead of thinking, like, oh, no, I might need an abortion, my daughter's going to think, oh, no, I just need to pick the right contraceptives. I was thinking back on my vaccine history because I was like, I've gotten all the vaccines, right? Then I looked at my vaccination card and I realized, like, oh, I never got HPV vaccine, which is why I got HPV in my 20s and then got the vaccine. But I remember my mom being with me at the gyno and the lady asking for something and I didn't know what it was. My mom's like, my daughter's not sexually active. She's not going to need that. But of course, as we know, HPV, you know, vaccines or birth control or anything else, they're not a reactionary thing. Sometimes they're a preventative thing. So like this woman who said that when she was assaulted, she was on birth control and then she took a method on top of that. That's someone who's prepared and then takes initiative into their own hands even after the fact. Like that is a really well-structured human. And you can see she has one of those really like, ooh, I was raped. Now what? You know, controversial backgrounds. So that's really interesting to me. I'm curious how people will, if they'll ignore that or move on. So this lady here, like I agree with her that conception is the bringer of life, that babies do start developing when that conception is happening, which makes sense. Like, oh, I'm pregnant. I'm not pregnant. Why? You know, it's not that hard. I don't need to play word games with myself. But at the same time, like, I'm still pro-choice because bodily autonomy trumps that thing growing within you, right? I think it does. I don't think it's good. I don't think it's healthy to have an abortion. But I also don't think we need to always think in the macro or the micro. Sometimes we just have to be like, is this right for me? Look, a fetus, I think, is Latin for small child or small, you know, something to do with a baby. If you watch H3 and H3, there was a controversy where Ethan's mom was worried that Trisha causing drama would cause Ela to lose the what? What was she going to lose, guys? What was Ela? Ela was pregnant and she was going to what? Lose the baby.
This is what I wrote.
Cover your okay. ears. This is it. The
I
worst
know.
Thing
this
you've
is
ever
the most
heard.
Horrible Go thing ahead. You've ever heard. Okay. Moses. If your sister has a miscarriage because of this stress, I will hold you and Trisha responsible. Stop this nonsense. Enough.
The truth is we were all thinking it, and I wasn't going to write it. So when I saw you write it, I was like, she shouldn't have sent the text, but like,
sorry.
I was thinking the same thing, honestly.
By also, the way,
yep.
The baby size now is the size of a bell pepper.
Hmm. Bell pepper? Pretty big. Pretty small still, though.
It's small, but that's pretty big, too, because you also have, like, everything else around it, like the water.
But just think, when you're getting kicks, it's a little creature this
oh,
big.
Yeah.
Going, tick, 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 tick.
It's kicking a lot, actually. Tick, 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 tick,
tick. Little foot this size. Cute. Little Brucey. Oh, I just fucking told the name. You believe this idiot?
I do believe it.
So when I see people try to argue that it's not a baby, say that when your wife has a miscarriage and you wanted that child. Say that when someone's murdered and she's, you know, pregnant and she's 8 months along. Say that when we want that baby. And if you wanting something is the decision maker and whether or not it's ethical, like okay, that's fine, but don't claim you're thinking objectively. Because I don't know if there is an objective conversation to be had around abortion, except that it is a life and we are terminating it. Now we have to decide what that means, and I think all of that is very subjective. Because the truth is, we're pro-death penalty, pro-war, we're pro-abortion. We do not value life the way we think we do. But some of us do, and I think it's the ideal. I think we ideally want to respect life. We ideally want to love our neighbor. But most of us have a very hard time doing it, obviously. There you go. She's non-religious.
I am Ayala. I am 18 years old. I am from Charlotte, North Carolina, and I am anti-abortion. One misconception that I deal with pretty frequently is that we're all Christian, white, old men. And as a, you know, Jewish woman, younger, I really want more voices like mine to be seen in the anti-abortion movement because I think we have new perspectives that would help kind of bridge the gap and have us find a little bit of middle ground between our two opposing sides.
Abortion is murder.
Ooh, here we go, baby. It's the question of the video. Oh, I'm so excited. Murder on the murder train.
I think it is murder. I think for the abortionist more so than the woman. I think a lot of women don't necessarily know exactly how an abortion procedure is formed. I've had a girl even tell me that at 20 weeks, a baby is just a clump of cells, and that's just not true.
I do believe now there might be cases where you know, some women might be unaware of what's going on in an abortion. But by and large, I think, especially with the advent of the internet and so much education out there, many of them do know that the life that there's a life inside of them, and they want to end that life, whether they call it murder or not.
Hard disagree. Absolutely disagree.
Okay.
I've definitely met a lot of teenage girls who grew up in our generation who believe that abortion is normal, a fetus is a clump of cells, and there is no human life in the womb. They don't tell you when you go in for an abortion consultation. This is a child, and this is a human life, and that's what's going to be happening. I have a hard time believing that if most women knew they were killing a child, they would do that. I don't think women in America are that malevolent. I think it's very irresponsible and very hurtful to say, oh, this woman's a murderer because she had an abortion.
Aha, okay. This girl is on top of it, right? She's culturally, I'm assuming culturally Jewish than religious Jewish, but you correct me if I'm wrong, girl, if you watch this video. But I like her, right? Good thought process. She's trying to find the nuance and she's trying to be honest. To be honest, guys, most people, myself included, this is how I ultimately see abortion, right? Forgive me, but this is how I see it. A tadpole and a frog, right? I'm going to drain that pond and kill all those tadpoles and I don't really feel bad about it. But if I drained a pond and I saw like 100 dead frogs, I'd be like, fuck, I fucked up, bro. Like there's a physical representation of my consequence. But the truth is like a lot of our consequences are mental. Either way, I think it's pretty clear like pro-life, pro-choice, we're stigmatized by the people fighting for us the most radically sometimes. And I think that's a really hard thing for all of us to swallow is that we are again contributors to our environment, and we just don't want to believe we are.
At least my personal experience, the people who worked there were very understanding. They let me know there is a child that could come out of you in 9 months. Are you sure you want to do this? I knew there was a child in my body. I knew I could have a child in 9 months, and I knew that that child can grow old and be their own person. But I made that choice because I am allowed to have that choice. And especially you, you are a white man, and you are not allowed to say what I can do with my body, nor any of these other women who are able to carry a child.
I think that's so dangerous. I think that's so dangerous to say that you can't say because of your sexuality, who you are as a male or female, or how you believe as a religion, you can't define what's right and wrong. I think that's misguided.
You can
and
have
we shouldn't
your own
take
opinion.
That into policy.
I think what she's saying is that whatever your morality is, I think that, you know, folks are entitled, that we have freedom of religion, we have freedom from religion. Whatever your moral value is, the issue is trying to turn that into legislation and putting
but
it
legislatively,
on someone else.
We legislate what's right and wrong all the time.
I agree with both of them. Again, he's right that we do legislate all the time in relation to morals, right? And I think we should stop doing that. I think we should stop creating a law around whether something is wrong or right and start creating laws with what's most efficient for society and most fair for the human condition. So I think there are ways that we could be better, but also around the world, people do things differently. People have different rules for all kinds of people, you know, and I think we just need to acknowledge that as well. This is cultural, but this is also like introspective bubbleness as well. You know, I talk about the levels and I say like these are twos, right? These are people who believe like it has to be this way because it is right versus some of these people in this group, some of them are actually like it's less that it's right or wrong and more about maybe a little bit more efficiency. And I agree with him that it is very dangerous to start saying we can't have opinions about things because of what we look like or our lived experience. I think we should pay attention to the human condition as a real, beautiful, amazing, magical phenomenon in which we are all experiencing realities differently. You know how everybody has a different version of you in their head? Well, everyone has a different version of your opinion in their head and a different version of that opinion in their head and a different version of that opinion in their head. And so we're all trying to cohabitate on this planet. We're doing fairly well, but I don't think cutting off the conversation to people is the answer. But it is okay to have boundaries with who you have conversations with. And again, group thinking versus the individual thinking, there's got to be a balance. Where is the human condition in this conversation? Where is like the realness of being a human? I think it's in the meta of this conversation.
Okay. You know, like for Indigenous women, they're 2 times as likely to die from pregnancy-related complications. Who's responsible for that murder if she's forced to carry that baby?
Well, I would be all for working on legislation altogether where, you know, if the woman's been taken advantage of, or if they've incest situations, or if her life's at risk, we can keep those options on the table.
So all of a sudden, because she could potentially die, we'll make legislation where she can't abort that baby, and all of a sudden you're pro-abortion?
No, I'm not pro-abortion. I personally would not like her to choose that option. I think science
so
has come.
No.
I think science has come a long way where that's vastly not the case anymore within our medical community, and we need to continue to increase funding for those mechanisms to provide more research on how to keep the woman alive in those situations.
What is the end goal here, that abortion be illegal and it be criminalized and removed as a resource forever from this country? Is that the
illegal and unthinkable.
Illegal and unthinkable. Yes. So it is culturally tied.
Culturally for women. We want women to have resources, first of all, to where they don't need an abortion, and then abortion for the abortionist is criminalized. So an abortionist could go to jail for performing it. Women should not be criminalized because at the end of the day, women are victims of abortion as well.
Okay, wait, I want to pause it. How do we feel about this sentence? What do we think about this sentence? The idea that they're treating it kind of like sex work, which I also am against. Like, you know, don't criminalize the sex worker, criminalize the person going for it. You're still putting a moral equivalency through the law that limits people's bodily autonomy. So I'm always going to have a problem. If your solution is limiting people's bodily autonomy, then the conversation is not one of freedom. It is one of control. Period. The end. And so we have to have conversations about that. I know there are a lot of nuances in between this. Even my sentence of, you know, my sentence could be construed in ways to justify a lot of really horrible things. Don't do that. Don't be an extremist. Like, be realistic about the human condition. Sometimes people get pregnant. Sometimes they have abortions. Sometimes people get pregnant and they keep those babies. Sometimes people have abortions because they think there's no other choice. And sometimes people have abortions because they have every choice. It's all the right answer because it's so subjective to the lived experience of that individual and so in a bubble of its own. You know how I talk about people's bubbles in terms of introspection? There's cultural bubbles, race bubbles, sex bubbles. There's even a bubble within yourself. You know we're in denial, right? When we're in the middle of recovery or trying to get better. You know those moments where you go dark and you hide in your closet and you sink into a hole and you justify everything you're doing because you think, in this moment, I have to, I'm in this situation. Well, maybe, but eventually when you've grown up or slash gotten out of that cycle of like, I'm going to pretend, you know, see no evil, you know, hear no evil slash no responsibility taken because I didn't know better. When you get past that stage and you're really coming into your own, I want you to be able to say, you know, I'm getting an abortion because I want to. I want to is a perfectly good reason. And at the same time, say it's kind of a bummer and like this baby would have been someone, but it doesn't really matter because they're not yet. And that's really hard for us to process. Now, I personally have been nannying. I've been raising babies my whole life. And for me, I think babies, their personalities and who they are come out day one. I think even in the womb, they have personalities. But I think, you know, they start to show those personalities when they're big enough to kick and big enough to be a presence. So again, we run into the tadpole frog argument. It's hard for me to feel like this is a tangible argument when I have no physical evidence. Now, I'll give you another example. Burning building, right? Like 30 like embryos ready to be like fucking implanted. And then a 3-year-old baby girl, the building's on fire, it's burning down. Which one do you save? It's like, well, obviously I'm gonna save the one that physically represents what I know as a human being, the little girl who's 3. And I'm going to let those embryos in the tray die because they don't represent what I know as a human being. But that doesn't take away the fact that they were living and they have something happening. An organism is living. Like, this isn't a living plant, but this is a living plant. Like, I'm very scared to touch it. This is a living plant. This is alive. It's alive, right? Even though, you know, you could argue that it's not alive in the way I'm alive. Basically is, though. I mean, minus the consciousness. And even at that point, are you saying humans in comas don't have the right to live, or people who are, you know, have a limited cognitive ability aren't human because they don't react the same way we do? The line is so blurred because this is not a black and white issue. If it was this simple, we wouldn't be debating it forever. You know what I'm saying?
My name is Sebastian King, and I am anti-abortion side. My mom had an unplanned pregnancy because she was taken advantage of from the time she was 12 to 15, and she was in and out of state custody, and a judge even encouraged her to have an abortion and told my mom that she won't amount to anything in life if she goes through with this pregnancy. Because she chose life, that's the only reason I'm here today, and that's my mission, is to ensure that all life is protected.
I love that. It's a real lived experience. This is what his life has taught him. In the same way, how can you ask a rape victim who had an abortion so she wouldn't give birth to that baby? How can you ask her why she did that any more than you can ask him what he's doing? It's so clear. It is so clear why we do the things we're doing. Can you really fault him? Now, I think this is the good example of like a two bubble. They really mean well. They really do. They're great. It's not a bad thought process. He's really grateful for his existence. Funny enough, there's this like TikTok trend I've been seeing about how like two people 20 years ago decided to bump uglies and now I have to exist. And there's a lot of people who talk about, you know, anti-birth movements, or they don't think it's fair that we didn't consent to be here. But see this man, he loves his life and he's so grateful to be here. How can you fault him for wanting everyone to be as happy as he is? You can't. And I same with the people who are pro-abortion. They feel like it saved them, like it really benefited them. So again, when we're having these conversations, we really need to decide, you know, is my way the highway, period, the end, for all people? Or do I need to challenge myself in a way that will force me to be introspective and might even force me to change my identity? And I think a lot of people are afraid to challenge their bubbles because they're afraid to start over again. But you don't really start over again. You just stand on the shoulders of your past self.
Abortion should be accessible to rape and incest survivors.
Well, obviously. I don't think anyone's going to disagree. Oh, never mind. I was like, no one's going to disagree on that.
And especially if you've been raped, there are some people who have that thought like, oh my God, like, what if I when I look at my child, I relive that trauma.
That's a reminder.
And not saying that's how all rape victims view it, but it's just like some women have that fear.
I was raped for 4 years of my life, violently, more times than I can count. And I did get pregnant when I was 15. My rapist threatened me with abortion multiple times. Used that as a tool to keep me in his power. If he had the power to terminate evidence, he had power against me. I did end up losing her, but I wanted her very badly. And I think it's very important to humanize people who are conceived in rape because they're walking around right now.
There's a lot of them.
There's a lot of them. And I think it's very insulting to place that on a human being. I think that humans, no matter how they are conceived, are human beings and they deserve to be respected and their lives deserve to be respected.
And I agree because that's me. I agree 100%. And my mom has always told me she doesn't view me as his, even on my birth certificate, he's not my father. So
also, I want to tap on what you said, though, because you said you really wanted to keep your daughter. And although you don't, you know, see it as the rape baby and stuff, other people who also go through that traumatic experience may actually see it like that, right? You wanted that, but there's other people that had their a choice taken away from them. They shouldn't be shamed at going through this, even having to live through that experience of the rape baby.
Here's the thing. When you get an abortion as a reaction to rape, you are continuing the cycle of violence. So you were raped. That was a violent experience that happened to you. That wasn't your fault. You're hurt. You've been victimized. Why is it fair to further victimize someone else because you are hurt?
I'm really sorry that you lost that child. And I also thought a lot about for myself when I went through that experience, what choice would be best for me. And for me, that was not carrying the child. And I think trauma is such an interesting thing. For me, not having control over a child growing inside of me and changing my fate of my life, you know, that would be more traumatic than the initial experience. We don't know how people are going to react, but I do fight and would want them to have the choice to do what's best for them. I think a strange misconception that people have about people who are pro-abortion is that we don't have respect for life or we don't care about children. That's absolutely not true. I respect life very much. Unfortunately, I've also seen a lot of negative aspects of our systems in the US, like the foster care system. It's out of that respect that I believe people should have the right to choose an abortion.
A lot of the what pro-life people would consider hostile pro-choice comments and things like that are a response to hostile pro-life people. Mm-hmm. And I think that doesn't get talked about in our side because we don't like to fight each other. But I think it's an important point because I've seen absolutely disgraceful comments made towards women who are going into clinics, you know, who are obviously in a very traumatizing situation, and you don't know what that woman is going through, and they're shouting obscenities at her. And that's appalling. And I think that we need to take responsibility as pro-life people to understand they've experienced so much hurt from our side of the community.
And I agree with that, I think. But from our side of the aisle, folks are very passionate because they believe that's a life, they believe that's a baby, and they want to do everything they can to save that child. But I agree that our rhetoric needs to be there as a resource and another option, and we can do that peacefully and respectfully as well.
Obviously, if you're going to be polarized, it's going to come across polarized. So pro-life, pro-choice people, I think they both have negative energy, negative examples of their people, negative all this stuff, right? And then there's a lot of positives. They're all saying the same thing, but they don't even know they're the opposites of each other. So ultimately, the answer has to be a third option, which is what I think my answer is. Ultimately, abortion is the termination of a human life in progress. How you want to process that, it has to be up to you. Because frankly, it's too complicated and gray, and there's so much that has to go into this conversation that is so contextualized that there isn't an objective answer, in my opinion. The answer is abortion murder? What is murder? I think it's taking a life against someone's consent, but then you have to discover through discussion whether or not you even believe a human fetus has consent. I feel like in the same way pro-lifers think abortion is murder, pro-choicers who happen to be anti-birth are people who think like having a baby against their consent is just as bad as killing it against its consent. But in some ways we weigh that, well, better of two evils, which I think most people do. And I don't think that's wrong. I think what's wrong is claiming to have an objective answer for a very nuanced subject. I think objectively the only thing we can say, again, is that after conception, that baby is in progress, that life is in progress, and that's it. Like, that's it. What does that mean, that it's in progress? I don't know. Except that it means that it is.
2 hours later.
So I'm stoned, but I was thinking about this thing. So dumb. But I was trying to think about, okay, if it's about timing, right? If this thing is about timing. I think one of my most controversial thoughts is just like the reality of context timing. So obviously it's a murder at one point, but not a murder at another point. We're all just debating what the point is. Same with rape and consent and everything else. If a guy slides into a girl and she's giving consent and then 10 seconds later goes, I revoke consent, is the action of him being inside her a rape? Is him sliding out to get off her, which is per her request, but also a thrusting motion of like, I'm pulling out, which could be seen as sexual. So is that the rape part? Same with abortion. It's like, at what point is it the abortion, the murder of child? And at what point is, you know, it's too contextualized based off the timing. And if that's the case, then ultimately it's just too nuanced to ever have a really concrete answer. And in that case, great debate, great conversation. I really enjoyed reviewing this video. I enjoyed talking about it with you guys. Let me know if you want me to do more in the future. Thank you for watching. Have the most fantastic day. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Two people had sex in the 90s, and now I gotta pay bills and live and eat and do bullshit. And they don't even like each other anymore, dude.